When it comes to writing up your quantitative findings chapter, you have got to be super strategic. You've got a lot of data. You've probably got a lot of analysis as well. And it would be incredibly easy for that to just descend into total chaos. So how do you keep your findings chapter organized? How do you avoid overwhelming or annoying your examiner? That is what we're going to look at in this video. I'm Dr. Elizabeth Yardley, and for the last 20 years, I've been supporting social science students through their dissertations at undergraduate, postgraduate, and doctoral level. And quantitative data always presents a challenge, largely because there's an assumption that you can just write it up. It's easy. It's just numbers. What's your problem? But actually, when you get into it, it is not that straightforward because you have to use those numbers to tell a story. That story has to make sense, it has to flow logically, and that is not an easy thing to accomplish. So in this video, I'm going to be giving you 6 top tips for your quantitative findings chapter. Here they are. This video is the 3rd in a 4-part series about all things findings chapters. So if you want to check out the others, I will link to them in the description. The first tip that I want to share with you is get messy. Okay, do not expect your findings chapter to get written up in one session, in one sitting. Don't expect your first attempt at this to be your last attempt at this, because you're going to go through various different iterations of your findings chapter. You're going to play around with the structure, with the content. You're going to put some things in, take some things out, then put them back in again. And it is going to feel frustrating and overwhelming and messy, but that is completely normal. You need it to be messy in order for it to be tidy, in order for it to be logical, and in order for it to be structured eventually. So just be prepared for it to be a messy process and know that that is perfectly okay. The second tip that I would give you is to come up with a basic structure to work with initially. And you want to start your findings chapter by presenting the descriptive statistics. So here you are just stating the obvious, essentially. And many students don't take the time to do this. They go straight into the complexity. But it is crucial. It is so important to include the descriptive statistics first. So things like means, standard deviations, frequency distributions. All of this data is massively important for your examiner because they need an understanding of the basics before you then get into the complexity. The examiner needs that foundation if they're to understand your later, more complex analysis. So please take the time to think carefully about your descriptive statistics and ensure that the examiner has all of the basic bare bone stuff that they need. After you presented the descriptive statistics, you need to structure the rest of your chapter around your research questions or hypotheses. Essentially, use them as provisional headings and then go from there. And be aware that this is going to change. As I said in the first tip, be prepared for mess, be prepared for chaos, but you need to start somewhere. So the best place to begin is with your research questions or your hypotheses. Use these as headings and then develop the structure from there. The third tip that I want to share with you is be really careful about your visual representations. So here I'm talking about things like bar charts, pie charts, graphs, diagrams, the kind of things that you would expect to find in any findings chapter. Now, the problem that I encounter a lot as an examiner, as a supervisor, as somebody who's done quantitative research myself, is that there is sometimes a tendency to fall into a bit of a trap of using the same type of visual representation for the whole of your findings chapter. So bar chart after bar chart after bar chart, or a very similar diagram kind of repeated multiple times for different variables. And in some instances, that's appropriate, but in most instances, it isn't. So you need to think about what is the most effective way to present your data. So go through each part of your findings chapter and think about what visual representations would be the best ones to present the kind of data you're dealing with there. Say there's a particular section and you're thinking about using a bar chart to represent that data. Just take a few minutes to think, is a bar chart the best way to convey the information here? What are the alternatives? Could I use a line graph? Could I use a pie chart? Could I use something else? And really take the time to consider that, to consider alternatives. When you do this, sometimes it will just confirm what you thought already and you'll think, well, yeah, this is the best way of presenting this data. And that's fine, because going through this exercise is a way of reassuring yourself, of justifying why you're using particular means to convey what you found. But at other times, it will make you stop and think and go, maybe that isn't the best way to present this data. And that can help you in terms of getting out of that trap that some students fall into of using the same way of presenting the data throughout their entire quantitative findings chapter. By taking the time to reflect and to check in with yourself about the ways that you're planning on presenting your data, you are much better able to judge whether that is the most effective way to present the data or not. And this helps you stay connected to your data. It helps you stay close to your data. And it's also helpful in thinking about the needs of the person who will be reading about your data. When you're keeping all of these things in mind, you will be much better at identifying ways of presenting your data that are going to help people understand it. The fourth tip that I want to share with you is about being consistent in the way that you're presenting your data. You've got to be consistent in terms of your fonts, in terms of your text size, and in terms of the color palette that you use in your visuals. When there is inconsistency, when you have got different size, different fonts, different colors across all of the representations of your data, and indeed in terms of the text you're using in the findings chapter, this can be a real distraction for the person who's reading it, the person who's examining it, because it makes it look amateur and scrappy and like you haven't been bothered to proofread it. It's really distracting for your examiner, and they're going to be more focused on the eyesore that is in front of them than on the quality of your data and the quality of your analysis. You need to have clear titles for your visuals, which are all in the same font and the same text size throughout. You need to have a standard color scheme if you're using color in your findings chapter. You need to make sure that you are labeling your diagrams and those kind of things appropriately. So when somebody's reading your findings chapter, they're not kind of left wondering, okay, is this figure one or figure two? What is this table? What portion of the text does it relate to? Another thing that you need to look out for are tables. Make sure that you're not including too much information in tables to the point where the text is becoming really small and it's going to be incredibly difficult for the examiner to read it. So where you've got a situation like this, that tells me that you probably need to reduce the number of items, of variables in any given table, or you might want to look at doing it in a different orientation. So if you have got a large table, rather than putting it in portrait format, you want to put it in landscape format. So just be really conscious of that when you're going through your findings chapter, because you have got to have your examiner on side in the findings chapter. You have got to make it as easy as possible for them to look at what you found, see how you've interpreted it, and not be distracted by kind of things that really you should be fixing as you're going through. Tip number five is about the analysis of the data. So you need to ensure that you are not simply describing your data. You need to point out to the person reading your thesis what data is particularly interesting and why. So rather than simply describing what table one shows, you want to point their attention towards particular things in table one. So you might say things like, of particular interest in table one are, and then go on to talk about things that are vastly overrepresented or underrepresented or statistically significant. Now, I did go into quite a lot of detail about analysis and description and synthesis in the first video in this series. So if you need a bit of help with that, check out this video because that explains all of these different stages. But the really important thing to get across is don't just present your data and not comment on it and not say anything else about it. That happens in a lot of findings chapters. I've come across many, many dissertations findings chapters where you just have like a description of the data. There will be a table and then there'll be a body of text which basically just tells me what's in the table. You need to go further than that in your findings chapter. You need not just to describe but also to analyze. Say for example you've got a stacked bar chart that shows you different age groups who participated in a particular event on a particular day. And one of the age groups is vastly overrepresented, another one is vastly underrepresented. You want to be commenting on that kind of thing. Don't just tell the examiner, don't just tell the reader there were X percentage of people or X number of people. You want to draw their attention to elements of your data that are particularly interesting. You need to point this stuff out for them. That is a really important thing to do, because you don't want your examiner to feel like they have to analyse your data for you, okay? You don't want to leave them to make sense of it for themselves. You want to be guiding them through it. You want to be walking them through it. You want to be explaining to them why this is important, how this is important, the kind of things that they should be looking at. And when an examiner can see that kind of detail, when a student has taken the time to comment, to talk about what's important and what's standing out within particular visuals, that's when students have done much better than when they've just described stuff. The last tip that I want to share with you is about the importance of integrating your visual representations with your text. Now, you shouldn't be in a situation where you have a table or a diagram or a graph that you don't refer to in the text. You should never leave stuff hanging in your findings chapter. Your examiner shouldn't come across stuff and think, well, so what? They haven't talked about this anywhere. They've not told me about the significance or the importance of it. What am I to make of this? You don't want that at all. Your examiner shouldn't have to figure that out for themselves. It's your job as the expert now to walk the examiner through that. So go through your findings chapter when you've written it up and check, are there any diagrams, tables, diagrams, I've said diagrams twice there, but any kind of visuals that are not referred to in the text. Now, if you do come across stuff like that, there are two possibilities. The first one is this is something that you could put in the appendix because it's supplementary information. The second possibility is you could refer to it in the text. So consider whether it's important, consider whether it's an essential thing to be talking about in the findings chapter, and then go from there. So there you have it, six top tips for ensuring that your quantitative findings chapter is absolutely marvelous. And to recap, they are. Firstly, be prepared for a bit of mess and chaos. You are not going to get your findings chapter right the first time, and that's perfectly normal. Secondly, develop a basic provisional outline structure, beginning with the descriptive statistics and then going on to the more complex analysis, using your research questions or your hypothesis to create an initial outline. Thirdly, make sure that you are using the most appropriate visuals to represent your data. And fourthly, be consistent in how you are presenting them. Fifthly, don't just describe your data, make sure you're analysing it too. And last but not least, ensure that all of your visual representations are referred to somewhere within your text. I hope you found this helpful in terms of beginning to plan your quantitative findings chapter, and be sure to check out the other videos in the series.